الحمد لله وكفى، وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون. نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة، ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون، نزلا من غفور رحيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. الله سبحانه وتعالى هو الرب، He is the one who has created us, and He is the one who keeps us alive. He is the one who gives us rizq. He is the one who provides us with everything. It's only because of His mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we are able to breathe, that we are able to see, that we are able to talk, that we are able to walk, that we are able to move. There's so many people who want to move, who cannot move. There's so many people who want to see, they cannot see. There's so many people who want to think, they cannot think. There's so many people who want to walk, they cannot walk. There's so many people who want to hold, they cannot hold. There's so many people who want to smell, they cannot smell. There's so many people who want to taste, cannot taste. So every single thing that we have been given is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of what He has given. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants all of us that we recognize His blessings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that we realize that everything that we have is a blessing, is a mercy, is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. When we say La ilaha illallah, we claim that we are believers, we are Muslims, we are the one who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as our Lord. The true meaning of La ilaha illallah is that there is nobody who can do anything except Allah. That's what La ilaha illallah is. But this thing has to come in the heart. We need to have this certainty in our hearts that La ilaha illallah. And when we say La ilaha illallah, that also means that when we take Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as our Rabb, then we absolutely believe in that, and then we have this certainty in our heart that nothing happens except with the will of Allah. And we are here in this dunya, in this world, in this life as the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to live this life according to His obedience, in His obedience, according to His commands. This is what La ilaha illallah is. So this is a test that we have been given, all of us. Every single person has a test that has been given. And that test is of La ilaha illallah. That you have said that Allah is your Rabb, Allah is your Creator, Allah is your Razik, Allah is your Khalik, Allah is your everything. So let me test you when you are saying La ilaha illallah. Right? this is what all this life is about. Life is that, you know, that you have said La ilaha illallah, now let me test you. If you pass the test, you're going into the paradise. If you fail the test, well, yadu billah, you're going into the hellfire. Or if there is a little bit of impurities that are in you, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove those impurities in the grave, in the hellfire, and may Allah protect us from that situation, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take those people out from the hellfire and put into the paradise. This test that we have been given, it has a few hurdles, of course, few challenges. It's not an easy test, because the reward is great. Reward is paradise. And paradise is something that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that no eye has seen and no ear have heard of that. It's such an amazing place. Right? So to get that, there are a few hurdles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put us in this dunya. And they're mainly of three types. The hurdle number one is nafs, people's own desires, the animalistic nature that people have within themselves, the desires, you know, desires of the opposite genders, want to look at somebody who's passing by, right? TVs, movies, billboards. This is one of the greatest tests, this nafs, biggest hurdles. Wants to eat, when it comes to eat, people don't even think what they're eating. Is it halal, haram, tayyib? What is that? People don't even, because they enjoy eating. Drinking. People have this desire to drink tasty drinks. They don't even realize what they're drinking. Having the desire of getting money. People don't even realize where they're getting money from. All what they want to look at is their bank balances. If it's increasing day by day, they're happy. If it's not, they want to do everything to increase their bank balance. Honor, respect, position. All of these are desires of the nafs. And then, whatever they want to do in order to get all of what they like, they can do. They will do. If it means like pulling somebody off, means backbiting, means having animosity, people go in extremes. It's so amazing to know that what the extremes that people go to in order to pull other people so that they can reach at that particular position, so that they can get what they're looking for. So this is hurdle number one, which is nafs. Hurdle number two is shaitan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put this enemy out for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he's your enemy, you also treat him as your enemy. He's your open enemy. Right, the different verses of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that he is your enemy. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him open permission. You know, you do whatever you feel like, but my people who say La ilaha illallah with their hearts, they're not going to listen to what you have to say. But they have to have this La ilaha illallah in their hearts. If they don't have that, like in a true sense, of course there will be people who will listen to you. And this is easier enemy than the nafs. Because nafs is like somebody who lives in our own house. And the thing is, we all love this of our enemy. We all want to listen to what it is saying, and we all want to fulfill its desires. All what shaitan does is, it comes and whispers in the ear. You know, look at that person. He is like not really behaving well with you. Why don't you go and shout at that person as well? That's it. This is all what shaitan says in the ears. Cannot do anything more than that. Now it's up to the nafs. If the nafs listens to what shaitan is saying and goes and try and implements that, the problem is with the nafs. Of course, problem is with shaitan as well, but nafs could have said, thank you very much for your advice, I'm not going to do what you're saying. But shaitan, that's all what it does. Shaitan comes, whispers, that's it. He never holds anybody's hands and take him to the sin. Never. He doesn't have the power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given him the power to do that. All what he does, comes, tells you, and comes in a way that he, like, you feel like as if he's your friend. This is what he said to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, and say the Hawa alayhi salam, you know, this tree, you know, if you eat that tree, you're going to live forever, so that you will be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forever. He knew that this is what Sayyidina Adam's alayhi salam's desire was, right? That he could worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forever. So he came to him as he was his friend. He comes to everybody as if he is his friend. He never comes and says, you know, I'm your enemy, you know, you do this, you do that. So, once, I can't remember if this is a hadith or not. I think it is. Anyway, I don't really remember. But somebody came to, there was a very, very pious person who never misses the Hajj. So once he was not able to get up in the morning for the Hajj. And when he got up, you know, he cried so much, you know, how come I missed my Hajj today? So the next day when he was sleeping, and then somebody came and woke him up. Say, you know, it's time for tahajjud. Say, you got up, you know, you say, thank you very much. You know, I could have slept today as well. You're such a beautiful friend of mine. You must be an angel. And no, I'm shaitan. Shaitan? How come you're shaitan? And then you're waking me up for tahajjud. I said, yesterday when you didn't get up and you cried so much, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted it so much that I didn't want you to get all of that reward today. Right? See, that's why I'm waking up you for the Hajj today. So he comes and tells, all what he wants to do is he wants to deprive people of their rewards. He doesn't want that anybody succeeds in this life. And he comes to everybody in their own, in different shapes and forms, and he always acts as if he's a friend. All of the thoughts that come into our mind, which are actually against the Sharia, Shaitan comes and whispers as, you know, this is something that's going to benefit you. And you know, if nafs is not actually in the right mold, he's going to accept. And then when he's going to accept, then he's going to act in what he's saying, right? So this is hurdle number two. The hurdle number three are the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created people around us. And these, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I've made a few people fitna for you. I've made a few people fitna for you. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He asks a question in the Quran. He says, Atasbirun? Will you be patient? I've made a few people fitna for the other people. Atasbirun? Will you remain patient? Right? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from us. All what we need to do is that we remain patient. And all these people who become hurdle number three for us, we need to make sure that we do not listen to them as well, if it comes down to telling anything against Sharia. Anything against the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't listen to those people. But the matter of fact is there are people who become hurdle number three. Not everybody, but many, many people. Sometimes wife becomes the hurdle. Husband wants to walk on the path of the deen. Wife doesn't want to do that. Sometimes husband becomes a hurdle in the path of the deen. Wife wants to take hijab. Wife wants to do proper covering. Wife doesn't want to have TV in the house. Wife wants that children walk on the path of the deen. Husband doesn't want to do that. Right? Sometimes the brothers and the sisters, they become hurdle. You know, people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them tawfiq, they grow their beard, you know, the brother comes, what has happened to you? You become mullah, right, and this and that, and all of these kind of things, right? Possibly everybody has his own story. So these are the hurdle number three, the people. And the thing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that, you know, you have to pass this test. These are the hurdles that I put for you out there. You have to cross these hurdles. You have to make sure that you cross these hurdles successfully and come to me crossing these hurdles. And this is called mujahada. This is called struggle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants all of us that we struggle in His path. Everybody has his own hurdle. And everybody can look into their lives, can look into their hearts. Everybody has their own struggle. Some people they complain about their nafs. Some people complain about shaitan, all these whispers that come into their minds, all these thoughts, all these... They're worried. Some people have people. Other people have hurdles. Everybody has different issues. Some people have all of them. Some people have two of them. Some people have one of them. Some people have like one of these hurdles more than the other hurdle. But everybody has a hurdle. There's no doubt about that. Anybody who starts walking on the path of deen, he will have some sort of hurdle. He will have some sort of hurdle. But the beauty is that we have to cross these hurdles. Because the more is the challenge, the greater is the reward. The more is the challenge, the greater is the reward. It's just that, you know, these games, there is a professional, there are different levels, right? One is a professional level and one is an amateur level. But nobody, if you win an amateur tournament, right, the honor that you possibly get will not be as equal if you win a professional level, right? Because there are more challenges in the professional level as compared to the amateur level. So greater are the hurdles, the greater are the rewards. There are even the levels of Jannah. There are even levels of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put people in different levels. But the hurdles will be there. Hurdles are there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put hurdles in the path of the people based on their strength. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا. I do not burden people except what they are able to bear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never put burdens on people that he's not able to or she's not able to bear. It never happens. People think my hurdle is the biggest hurdle. You have not seen the hurdles of other people. If you had seen the hurdles of other people, then you would have understood or realized that, you know, my hurdle is no hurdle. People come and say, you know, this is happening and that is happening. And subhanAllah, you also hear the stories of the other some other people. Your hurdle is no hurdle at all. You are living as if there. In fact, there is no issue. I don't even see that you have an issue. Only if you had known the issues of the other people. But they have their issues, you have your issue, but Allah has given you your issue according to what you can bear. But the thing is, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you a hurdle, know that you are able to cross that hurdle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never gives hurdles to people that they are not able to cross. If you are not a professional athlete, you will not be asked to jump like what? 6 feet or 8 feet. No. You will only be given a test that you can cross. This is Allah's mercy on us, all of us. So never feel that, you know, if you have an issue in your life, that's an issue that you're not able to resolve. You are able to resolve that. It's only that you need that willpower. It's only that you need that strength. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that you cross this hurdle. And once you cross it, then the reward that's coming is great. But you have to cross it with wisdom. You have to cross it with strength. You have to cross it with patience. You have to cross it with remaining within the bound of Sharia. And once people cross these hurdles with patience, with courage, with willpower, right, then this is something called consistency, istiqama, on the deen. Remain consistent on the path of deen. There are some people, hurdles come and they feel that if they are not going to cross their hurdles, they prefer to stay on the other side of the hurdle. They do not want to cross it. If you are not going to cross it, how are you going to reach Allah, who is our destination, who is our goal? Our goal is La ilaha illallah, to have this pure certainty in the heart, to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're not going to cross that, how are you going to reach there? You're going to stay there forever. That's not our goal. You know, anybody who starts walking on the path of the deen, I feel happy about it. Like people come, mashallah, Allah gives them tawfiq. Good. But there's always a fear in the mind. What's going to happen? What's going to happen to him long term? People, mashallah, come in mahfil. People come in gathering. Inshallah. People come, but you might have realized people who have been coming for a long time. Their faces that you see, like you have been seeing 3 years ago, you don't see them today. What happened? No consistency. They might have had some hurdle. They were not able to cross that hurdle. And subhanAllah is so amazing that people go to heights sometimes. People reach like certain limits, mashallah, and you feel that mashallah he has been able to cross all the hurdles, and mashallah now he is strong. Allahu Akbar, things happen, and you know another hurdle comes, and that's there. I mean, they lose their hope there. So being consistent means that being consistent until our death. Consistency is not for a year, it's not for two, it's not for 5 years, it's not for 10 years, it's not for 30 years, it's not for 60 years. It is consistency until our death. We will be facing hurdles all our life. Something will happen. People come and say, you know, mashallah, you know, they had this issue of looking with desire at opposite gender. And subhanAllah, they work on themselves. They are able to get rid of that. 10 years down the road, you know, same issue is coming back. People are able to control their tongue. 5 years later, same issue is coming back. People are able to pray 5 times a day. Allahu Akbar, they start missing their prayers. Allahu Akbar, it's such an amazing thing. The sin that people were, they detested the most, they start doing that thing sometime later in their life. Just because some hurdle came, shaitan came, they let their nafs loosen the grip on their nafs. Something happens. Somebody came, you know, they got married later in their life. The wife came in their life. The husband came in their life. They were not like that practicing. Something happens. They want them to do the same thing as they are doing. Go away. Sometime a friend comes in their life. You know, what are you doing? Come on, let's go. Do this, do that. That's their hurdle. So istiqama, consistency, is that we keep on passing these hurdles all our life. People who have started fresh, inshallah, there's a long way to go. Until our death. Until our death. Remember we spoke about that story of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmahullah ta'ala. He's on his deathbed. On his deathbed. And we know who he was. Such a big faqih. Such a accepted person from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And his students were around him, and there were many, mashallah, and he's on his deathbed, almost unconscious. And they were doing talqeen to him. Talqeen is when somebody is dying, then you recite La ilaha illallah in a loud voice around him, around that person, so that he remembers and he's also able to recite that. They're all doing talqeen to him. La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah. And he kept on saying, La, La, No, No. And the students were, like, they were shocked. They all knew, right? Just what we are talking about. You know, they were all shocked that he might have got his hurdle right now at the time of his death. They were very, very sad. So suddenly, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahmahullah ta'ala, he opened his eyes. And he got consciousness again. And the student asked him, You know, we were doing talqeen to you. What happened? You were saying, La, no, 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 you didn't want to say that. I said, no, Shaitan came to me and he said, Ahmed, you were the one who got saved from me throughout your life. And I was telling him, La, no, I'm not saved from you right even now, because as far as I have breath within me, I have this ruh within me, I can never feel safe from you. So that's what I'm telling. I was telling Shaitan, La, not yet. Let me pass away. Let me go and meet my Creator. Only after that I will be able to say that I've Allah Subhanahu wa Taala has saved me from this hurdle of yours. Hurdles keep coming back. Our job is to make sure that we always recognize and realize our hurdles. And then we are able to cross that hurdle all the time. People come, they start studying. Right? MashaAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them tawfiq. They come, start studying. Just like, and you feel that he or she is the best student in the class. Just a year down the road, I mean, things happen that you can't even imagine. You know, this person, he or she is saying that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just snatches that thing away from that person. The tawfiq doesn't remain with that person anymore. Some hurdle comes. And if that hurdle is from within the nafs, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the tawfiq away from that person. Sometimes people feel, you know, mashallah, I'm so good. I'm so gifted. Right, all of these pride start coming into the heart, and because of that, this is a nafs, right? It's a hurdle of the nafs, and because of that hurdle of the nafs, when people start feeling arrogant in their heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala snatches that thing away from them, that tawfiq, gone. We have to be very, very cautious and very, very careful about all of these hurdles. If things coming from the nafs, make sure that we cross that. Don't let nafs attack us. If it's coming from Shaitan, make sure that we cross that hurdle. Don't listen to what Shaitan is saying. If it's that hurdle from the people, make sure that we handle with them very wisely. I mean, keeping ourselves within the Sharia, within the folds, but at the very same time, making sure that, you know, all the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also met while dealing with those people. This third hurdle is very sensitive hurdle. Very sensitive hurdle. So we have to remain consistent. We have to remain strong all our life until our death. And this is the test of La ilaha illallah. This is the test of La ilaha illallah. And one of the ways that, you know, this test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes that easy is what we spoke about last time. We should make sure that we are hooked up to somebody who has a chain going back all the way to the Prophet ﷺ. Because of the barakah of that, people do slip. I'm not saying people don't slip. But the thing is that at least they get this realization in the heart that, you know, so I've done something wrong. This is ajeeb barakah. This is ajeeb barakah. It's exactly what Prophet ﷺ said. If you leave that company, and you're out alone fighting all of these hurdles by your own self, then it's like a sheep that has gone out of that group. That's very easy for wolves to come and attack that sheep. It's going to take that away. If you remain hooked up, then, you know, if you start slipping and may Allah protect, you know, and you've been coming to the gathering every Thursday, I mean, you're not coming to Thursday, I'm going to call somebody and call you. What's happening? Where are you? And maybe just by that one call or one email, possibly even give you a realization, you know, I've been slipping. People do slip, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them tawfiq to do tawbah. They keep coming back. But the idea is to keep coming back. Nobody is safe from, we're all weak. We all slip. But the idea is that we keep coming back. We have to make sure that if, you know, we wanted to cross that hurdle, you know, say it's a high jump, right? Have you seen the high jumps in the Olympics? People try to cross that, they want to make that high jump. Sometimes they're not able to cross that hurdle. Their foot touches that or their hand touches that and the hurdle drops. And they do not qualify, but the thing is that they have to come back. They're given chances. They're giving possibly two or three chances. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us infinite chances. If you're not able to cross that hurdle, come on, don't worry, try again. You're not, again, you slip, don't worry, come again, try again. Keep trying. The thing is, we have to keep trying. We cannot lose hope. Never. Somebody sent me an email. You know, I've been trying to leave this sin forever now. I think that I'm not a worthy student. This and that, you know. Nobody's a worthy student. Nobody's a, like, I'm not a worthy teacher as well. But the thing is that you have to keep trying. You cannot, this shaitan, this another hurdle, hurdle upon hurdle. Shaitan saw you not being able to cross that hurdle. He says that he wants you, that you lose hope altogether. Two hurdles now. At least you have to just ignore one hurdle. Thank you, Mr. Shaitan. All what you're saying is wrong, and I'm going to go and retry. This is what we all need to do. Retry. Even if you're not able to cross that hurdle, but keep trying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves that. He loves that. You can't even imagine how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves that. It's like, as our mashayikh say, it's just like a small little child. You know, 1 year old, the parents want him to start walking, right? And they want him to try. If he's going to keep, like, stay in his crib, he's never going to walk. The parents want him to try and try walking. And you know, the parents are around him and they hold his hands and they like make him walk two steps and they leave him. And he walks like two, three steps, and as soon as he starts falling, the parents come and they grab him. Right? But the matter of fact is that the parents, they love seeing him trying. And he's trying to walk. He's trying to cross that hurdle of not being able to walk. That he feels, the baby feels, of course he doesn't feel, but like virtually speaking, he feels that his legs are weak. He doesn't have muscles developed, he cannot walk. But the parents love that. You know, you try. If you're going to fall, I'm going to come and hold you. Don't worry about that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also does the same thing. You try. And if you have this willpower in your heart that I'm going to continue trying, don't worry, I'm never going to make you fall down. I'm going to come and grab you. I'm going to come and hold you. You have to show that intention in your heart. That you know, I have made this intention that I'm going to walk on this path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until my death. Hurdles will come, hurdles will go. I may slip, I may fail some hurdles, but I'm going to come back, do tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what I've done, and I'm going to retry to cross that hurdle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you make this intention in your heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I am going to help you. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Whoever struggles in my path, I will surely guide him to my path. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promising that, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. I will surely guide him to my path. You have to make this intention in your heart. Make sure that you never lose your hope. Make sure that you never say that, you know, this is it for me. I've been trying this method for so long, you know, I think it's not for me, it's not working. It is working, you don't realize that. The thing is that shaitan comes and tells you this thing in your mind, that possibly you know, it's not for you. It is for you. Make sure that you don't lose hope. That's the thing. Make sure that you make an intention in your heart that you're going to cross that hurdle. I'm not able to cross that. Doesn't matter. I'm going to retry. And as I said, hold somebody's hand. Hold somebody's hand who has crossed that hurdle so that he's going to give you tips. Get a coach. All the professionals, that's how they win. Every professional is a coach. Every professional who wants to achieve something in his life, he is a coach. Hold somebody's hand. And of course, everybody, the coach and all of these people, they hold Allah's hand, virtually speaking. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes everybody to their destination. But we have to show that consistency. We have to be consistent. We have to make an intention in our heart that this is my goal, this is my aim. I'm going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a state that I will never lose my hope. I'm always going to cross my hurdles, and I'm always going to remain consistent. Always. Irrespective of what happens. Because this is what my life is for. This life is not for eating and drinking and enjoying, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't stop you from doing that. As far as they are within bounds, within limits. You can enjoy everything with what's within the limit. But the thing is not going out of the bounds. This is not what our life is for. That you cross the boundaries of set by Allah and you do whatever. This is not what our life is for. Our life is for that we remain within the bounds set by Allah. Keep trying, keep struggling, keep walking on the path. Do whatever is required so that when it's time for our death, we pass this test. This is what our life is for. This life is a test. We have to pass it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants that we remain consistent. We have this istiqamah. Some people, mashallah, they're with you, you live with them, right? And you know that they, mashallah, pray 5 times a day, they don't do this, they don't do that. They leave the country, go to some other place, you meet them 10 years down the road, and this totally different person asking, what happened? You know, I couldn't get the good company. Okay, so didn't get the good company, so what? Sure, it's going to help. But you are going in your grave by yourself. When you are dying, your wife is not going to be with you in your grave. Your husband is not going to be in your grave. Your children are not going to be with you in your grave. All of you are going in their own graves. So, because my wife didn't want that, or my husband didn't want that, or my father, or my mother, or my children, or this and that, and my friend, if they didn't want that, so what? You're not doing things for them. We are doing things for the sake of Allah, who is our creator. Once Imam Sirri Saqti rahimahullah ta'ala, this is a story. It comes in the book. Once he was passing by, he was traveling, and he slept under a tree. And when he got up, the tree spoke to him. And the tree said to him, "O Sirri, become like me." He said, "What do you do?" He said, "People throw stones at me and I give them fruits in return." You know, they're fruit trees, especially they're high trees, the way that especially kids, children, if they want the fruits of the tree, they throw stones at the tree so that the fruits come down. They throw stones at the tree so that the fruits come down. He said, "The people throw stones at me and give them fruits." He says, "So become like me. People shout at you, people scream at you, people hurt you. You always benefit other people. That's what you should do in your life. So Imam Surri, he said that, you know, O tree, if you're so good, then why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to burn you in the fire? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made you a source of getting fire? And he says, you know, I'm good, but there is one thing that's bad in me. He said, what's that? He said, when the wind blows, wherever is the direction of the wind, I also turn that way. That's a problem in me. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, you become source of fire. This is what people do. Wind blows this way, they turn this way. Wind blows that way, they turn that way. They are in the group of, if they're in this gathering, mashallah, you see everybody, you know, sunnah dress, doing their zikr, listening attentively. Go back, and tomorrow, Friday night, they're with their friends, going out to a movie, and then gossiping, backbiting, talking bad stuff. What happened? Yesterday you were, mashallah, you were the biggest Sufis, you know. Wherever the wind blows, you turn that way. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that you become consistent. You become consistent. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you remain consistent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, that indeed whoever says that our Lord, our Rabb, our caretaker is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, and they remain consistent on that. And the ulama have written different tafsir of as to what does it mean. They say that whenever they say that Allah is our Rabb, that means that they have this La ilaha illallah in their heart. ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, and they remain consistent. That means that they made sure that every single thing that they do in their life, they do it with this thing in their heart. That thing, they do it with thinking that if this thing is going to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they have said this. My Allah is my Lord. This is Allah has given me this life, and this is a test, and there are a few hurdles that Allah has given me in this life. So every single time that anything comes in their life, they always think first that what Allah wants from me at this stage. This is istiqamah. This is being consistent in saying that Allah is my Lord. This is the tafsir of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. That they said La ilaha illallah and they always kept that. Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Uthman Ghani radiallahu anhu, he said that this istiqama means that you have the purity of intention in all your actions. That everything that you're doing is only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's istiqama. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that al-istaqamatu an tastaqima ala al-amri wa nahi, that istaqama is that you get hold of all the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is his commandments and what he has forbidden, and then you do not find ways to run away from that. A thing comes, you know, a situation comes, and we are trying to find ways that how can I get away with that? How can I do something that I be able to pass this, even if that's against the Sharia? That's not istiqamah. Right? You're always, you know that you're never traveling alone because you are a woman, right? And you have sharan, you cannot travel by yourself, and now something very important came, and now you're trying to find things, you're trying to find ways, how can I get some way that I can travel by myself. If there is a fatwa out there for some reason, I'm not saying there is not. I'm just trying to give you an example that people try to find ways as to how can I do this thing even if it's against the Sharia. This is not istiqam. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. The people who said that my Lord is my Rabb is is Allah, and then they remain consistent in that. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. That angels come to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down angels to them, these people. And they say to these people, أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. That don't be afraid, don't be sad. وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ. And they give them glad tidings of paradise. أَلَّتِي كُنْتُمْ. What is that? أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ أَلَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوْعَدُونَ. The paradise that was promised for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that if you remain consistent, if you keep crossing these hurdles, then your result is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The result is the paradise. Right? So these angels, if you remain consistent, angels come. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends them angels. And they say that, you know, don't be afraid. Don't fear. You're going to die. Right? And you're afraid what's going to happen with your family. These angels come to you. Don't be afraid. Allah is there to take care of them. So they have no fear at the time of their death. And there are different riwayat as to when these angels come. And the majority, they say that either they come at the time of their death, or they come at the time when they are going to be raised up again at the time on the Day of Judgment. And so when people are dying, this is something they know. People don't want to die. What will happen with my family after I die? My small little kids, what's going to happen to them? My wife doesn't have a source of income, what's going to happen to her? These are the fears that people have in their minds. What if I die today? And they're dying if they have remained consistent in their lives, if they've crossed all the hurdles, they've kept on trying, they've not changed their ways every single day of their life. When they're dying, angels come, they say, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of anything. Neither of the things that you're living in this dunya, and nor be of the things that are going to come to you in the graves in the hereafter. Don't be sad. And they give them the glad tidings of the paradise that is promised to them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them, that if you remain consistent, this is your prize, this is your reward. They tell them, you know, you won. Well done. This is what it's saying. You did wonderful job. You remain consistent. You really said La ilaha illallah. You said Rabbuna Allah, that my Lord is Allah, our Lord is Allah. And you remain consistent. All the hurdles that came in your life, you crossed those hurdles, knowing that what you had to do in your life. Angels come to you at the time of your death, and they say, you know, don't be worried, don't feel worried, don't feel sad. And he said, you know, you have won, well done, and your reward is paradise, and that was promised to you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's promises are true. And then these angels say that نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاءُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. That we were your helpers in your life, and we will be your helpers in the hereafter as well. And then they said وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ. And then when they will be entered into the paradise, and it will be said to them that you can have whatever you wish. Whatever your nafs desires, وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ. Whatever your nafs desires now, you can have whatever. You can have all of that now. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ. And you will have there whatever you will ask for. You withheld your nafs in the dunya, you wanted to be to look at that particular person, and you held yourself, you didn't raise your eyes and staring at that person. Today, now you go and enjoy it. You, whatever you want, your nafs wants, you can have that. Whatever your nafs wants, you can have that. It comes in the hadith that, you know, there will be birds flying and you want to eat, right? Barbecue of those birds that you feel like, you know, if it can come in your plate right now, it will come in your plate right there and then. Allahu Akbar. Whatever your nafs desires, you will get that. Because there are no bounds set anymore. All the bounds are lifted. Right? No boundaries. The boundaries were in this dunya. You were supposed to withhold yourself, you withhold your nafs from certain things. You withheld your nafs, now there is no bound. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ. You can have whatever your nafs desires. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ. And you can have whatever you will ask for. So stop your nafs. Make sure you cross this hurdle of your nafs, which is the biggest hurdle, by the way. And you will have whatever your nafs will desire in the paradise. But for that, we have to remain consistent. This is the reward of remaining consistent in your life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says after that, Allahu Akbar, nuzulam min ghafurir rahim. That this is the ikram, the honor given to you by a host who is forgiving, who is merciful. And then ulama say that it's just like, and that means that one thing is that your nafs will desire and you'll get that. But say for example, you go to somebody's place as a guest, right? And that host, they really do a lot of ikram of you, they honor you a lot. And you don't even know what they have cooked, right? Or what they have stored for you. And you go there and they put 7, 8, 10 different types of dishes in front of you. And especially they know what you like. And they put everything in front of you on the table and you don't even expect all of that. This is what a host does to the guests, especially the guests who they like. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves these people of istiqama, of consistency, who have crossed all the hurdles all their life until their death. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Nuzulam min ghafurur rahim. Ulama say that one something is their nafs is going to desire, and the other thing is they're going to get something from a host that you will not even be able to imagine that is going to give, that will be given to me in the paradise. But this is only the reward of being consistent. It doesn't come, it's not something that everybody is going to get. It is saying Rabbun Allah, that our Lord is Allah, saying La ilaha illallah from the heart, from the core of the heart. That means that every single thing that we do in our life, we have to always first judge what is my Allah's order here. And then doing it according to that. That's La ilaha illallah. That's saying Rabbun Allah. And then not doing it for a day, for two, for three, for a year, for five, for ten. Until your death. ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. And then all of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised is going to come. And believe me, Allah not only gives it in the hereafter, Allah gives it also in this dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also gives this in this dunya. Sometimes the hurdles are big, depending on the iman of the people. But once we cross that hurdle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives that in this dunya as well. And when hurdles come, sometimes when hurdles come to people, the people of iman, that increases in their iman. They know where it's coming from. And in the Ahzab, the incident of Ahzab, this war, where they dug the ditch, Right? When the kuffar, the non-believers, they were coming to fight against the Muslims, they were gathering everybody who was coming in their way. They were saying that, you know, if you're not going to come with us, we are going to fight against you. So everybody was coming, everybody was coming. Right? And the people, the Jews of the of Medina Munawwara, they came to the Muslim and they said, you know, this is what's happening. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls that in the Quran. It said, Inna nasa qad jama'u lakum fakhshawhum, that these people are gathering for you. Fear them. They're all coming. There's like a huge enemy coming. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allahu Akbar, these sahaba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wa ma zadahum illa imanu wa taslima. It did not increase in anything in those people except their iman and their submission. Then they did not, they were not afraid. They knew what they were doing. They knew it's a hurdle, and they also knew that if they had, if they remain consistent, if they remain trying, if they have that, if they keep this intention in their heart that I'm going to struggle, they know that Allah's promise is that He's definitely going to help us. And I said, okay, that's fine. And they did not increase in anything except their iman and their submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah, we all know what happened. Allah helped them. Allah always, subhanahu wa ta'ala, always helps. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always helps. It's just that, my friends, that we have to show that courage when the hurdle comes. Have to show the courage. Have this intention in the heart that I'm going to cross it, inshallah. As I said, if you want to get a, if not if you want to, get a coach, take a help from your coach. Make sure that you get your mashwara, you take advices, and then try to cross that hurdle. If you fail, come back, try again. Fail, come back, try again, keep trying. But have this intention in the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never, ever, ever, ever let you fall. I can guarantee you that. He will never let you fall. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only what He wants is, He wants you to try. He wants to see you try. When He sees that you have this jazbah, this courage, this zeal in your heart, this desire in your heart, that's all what He wants. And then we ask Allah, oh Allah, we are weak. We cannot do anything, you know. The shaitan, we can't even see him. He comes and attacks our nafs, you know. You yourself have said, you know, this is something that's within us. The desires, they're so great. The people, you know, there are so many emotions involved, and you know, somebody comes with their different emotions and they try to like blackmail you with something, you know, don't you love me? Can't you do even this thing for me? This, that, all of these sorts of things. Allah, I'm weak. You are strong. I want to try. I have this intention in my heart. I want to remain consistent. I want to reach You. I want to pass this test. Ya Allah, please help me. Allah loves them. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then He sends down angels in this dunya to help people. Definitely at the time of our death. In our graves. And also at the time when we all are going to raise up on the Day of Judgment. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ